Good morning. It is good to see you all. This is kind of a topic that is difficult. You know, love is, it's hard to talk about because people are so confused by it. And we, Ed, hopefully you've followed along in 1 Peter, how to get through life. And remember, 1 Peter's writing to Christians who are being persecuted, not American persecution, you know, where, oh, they don't like me because I don't go to that type of show. Not American persecution, but where they will kill you persecution. And so they're being scattered and God's working. And Peter is giving them instruction on how to live the journey. And we're about to enter chapter 2 and we've seen it. And so I don't know about you. I don't want to get through life and just survive. I kind of like to enjoy life. Now, that doesn't mean all my circumstances and all my situations and everything day to day is enjoyable. But Christians should do more than just tolerate life. We should enjoy life. And now some of y'all are like, yeah, no, I'm not talking about the enjoyments of life. I'm talking about enjoying life. Because some of y'all, if you don't have one of your happy toys, you're disappointed. You know, someone broke your toy and now you're sad and now you're down and you're just weeping and because you don't have any inner joy, you don't have any inner growth, you're just surviving. So living life in the Lord. First of all, you got to be saved. Please get that. Jesus died for the whole world, but the whole world's not saved. If you're not born again and a child of God, this scripture is really not for you other than to get you saved. There's a whole lot of worldly people today that quote scripture, and many of them are running for president that aren't saved. And they'll just quote scripture and they can't, right? You know, because someone put it in their speech and now they're stumbling over it trying to figure it out. But then after you're saved, you're being perfected as a child of God. God says, I'm going to take you through some seasons. Seasons aren't great when you're going through them, but they're awesome when you come to the other end and you're skilled, or you've grown in the Lord, or you moved forward and closer. And then he wants us to look past here to there. You know, it's about heaven, is it not? This world is not my home. I'm just a passing through. We got to get back to that as Christians. We're building too many kingdoms here. We're living way too much for what is tangible instead of what is intangible. And God encourages us what? To lay up treasures where? In heaven. In heaven. I hope you have some heavenly treasures. Hope you have some heavenly treasures. And then I hope you hear the music of salvation. Some people have a religious salvation. You know what I mean? I've done that. I prayed, I was wet, and now I am. And I went to Sunday school until sixth grade. And so, you know, because we're still stuck in it, you know, back ages where if you're a Christian, get an eighth grade Christian education, you're okay. And because you have to go work, be in the real world. You know, it's growing in Christ, growing in the Lord. And hopefully, though, you know something about it. I mean, I'm so fearful for a lot of people here that they haven't experienced salvation. It's just cognitive. It's just mental. It's just a verse. You know what I mean? It's not where the Spirit of God lives. And then from that, you live obediently, and we looked at that last week. Hopefully you understand, as children, we live obediently. What does that mean? God says it, we do it. Pretty clear, is it? Well, what does he really mean by that? That's where we are in Christianity. You know, if God says it, then what we do, we retreat to this phrase. Well, he really means, what's your heart attitude towards it? No, he meant, don't build any idols. It ain't an idol unless my heart goes there. He said, no graven image. Why? Because he knows eventually whatever you built to remind you will pretty soon become an idol that you're attached to. Y'all understand that? Oh, it's just to remind me. Okay, let me throw it on the ground. Break it. I mean, we got trees around here we can't touch. They were given because some died. And we got to wait for you to go so they can go. You know what I'm saying? Anyway, which is fine, but they become idols, right? One time they're a reminder, and then they become an idol. And God says, don't even make anything. Just worship me. Just worship me. Well, it really is a matter of a heart what an idol is. I know that. It starts with building something, right? That wasn't part of the message. That was just the message. And y'all are reacting about the same way. Anyway, this morning, let's look at love, okay? Love's got to be easy to look at, right? Love, man. You ever just really try to defining love? A hard thing, isn't it? Define love. Ask people, what is love? You get all sorts of weird stuff. You know, define it in one word, and people a lot of times will say it means acceptance, right? Have you heard that? How many have heard is love is acceptance? I've heard that all the time. Well, if you love me, you'll accept me as I am. I can't find that anywhere. And now we've even grown into this phrase, unconditional. Find that anywhere in the Bible either. The two biggest phrases you hear about love, it's unconditional and it's acceptance, I find nowhere as a definition of love. I don't. Matter of fact, I've used that. Well, you know, God accepts us. That's love. And then I realize he doesn't. And then it's unconditional. He loves me unconditional. And then he doesn't. And y'all are looking at me like, what? No. Everywhere in Scripture, see, if we don't get love right, we're going to miss it in the church as a proper bonding agent. So we got to get love right. See, we're all going, well, we just got to rust for who. Partially is true. But we also have to look at the reality of who Russ is. Not once have we said, Russ, sing a solo. Because I'll sit close enough, and we're sometimes on the same key. And if he's on my key, he ain't on anyone else's key. You know what I'm saying? Well, you just got to accept him. Well, I accept him as long as he's sitting there, but don't give him a mic. I don't know. Can you sing? I didn't think so. He's sitting there crying. I can sing, man. I know I can. God's love. I want you to get this. It's not unconditional. God's love has a condition of repentance. His love is there, but for you to get it, there's a condition. You're not sitting in oblivious, and all of a sudden the love of God goes, hey, I'm here. And we always go to the wayward son, the prodigal son. Well, he still loved him. He did. But what did he have to do? had to come back. Right? Right? Yo. But you get this, because this is some foundational things we got to understand, because God does love me, and His love has no conditions of my ability to give love back. But there is a condition that I repent. Unless you repent, what? You should all likewise perish. So I can't just be arrogant and go, well, He loves me no matter what. No, he wants me to repent. God's love changes you completely, right? Well, He loves me like I am. He loves you like you are, but then He wants to change everything about you. Sort of like your wife. And then if you hang around long enough, they go, it's unchangeable. Right? God love. I see, I got to get you to get these thoughts that are there a little bit shaken, because we want to go, well, God just accepts me the way I am. Well, God saves you. Let me put it this way. God takes you the way you are, but He doesn't accept you the way you are. Because once He gets in, He wants to change you. Isn't that interesting? Look here. God's love washes you up. No? It's like, look, I'm going to clean you. I'm going to get rid of some of this junk. I'm going to start washing. Because we're washed. Why am I righteous? Because He put on His righteousness, not because of my righteousness. Why am I accepted? Because Jesus had made me accepted in the beloved, right? I'm made accepted. I'm not acceptable before God makes me accepted. God's love puts you on a new course. And it's called His course. So when we understand love, there are some things in our culture that we got to start pushing away. We live in this almost 60s without the marijuana. You know, we're just kind of, oh, peace, love. You know what I mean? We're just kind of this culture that wants to go, boy, we just love you. We don't care how you are. We don't care how you act. We don't care. And we're lying. Right? I mean, years ago, we had a kid. We finally told him to stop coming. Why'd you tell? Because every time he was here, he's stealing. Well, we got to love him. Well, eventually, you got to look. If you're coming, you're going to have to sit here and you can't use the bathroom. Right? Well, that ain't love. You just accept him. Well, I didn't see anybody go, hey, this kid's coming. He likes to steal. Could y'all get some money and just hang it out so he could just take it from you? Because he's got to be deceitful. Right? If you had someone at your house stealing every day, what would you do? Would you love them? We got to define it, right? Love's an interesting thing to me, and I hope you get it. Love without conditions is jello. There's just no benefit. It's just jello. Y'all ever have jello? This is America love right here. Just jello. Just. What love mean to you? Well, I don't know. Let me make it this. You know what I'm saying? What's love to you? And we just kind of rearrange it and we can play with it. Jello's kind of fun to play with, isn't it? That's, broke love. Why would just play with it? And this is what everyone thinks love is today, right? How do you, love. Well, it just means I accept it. Well, it doesn't even spell love now. Well, just accept it. Well, it's broken. It's just bendy. It's just mushy. It's just emotion. It's just slobbery. You know, it's the little dog wagging the tail. That's true love. That ain't true love. He has no sense of what true love is. Y'all know that? Even though the dog wags his tail, You know, our dog's just manipulative. Anytime after dark, if we stand up, he goes to the door. Because he knows there's a high probability we'll let him out. And then he doesn't care if he stays out there 1 second or 50 minutes. Why? He comes back in and gets a treat. That's all he wants. I tried to tell him, just get the treat. Stop annoying me. Why? We condition. Oh, he loves you, though. He jumps on there. He just wants to be petted. He has no concept of love, does he? I mean, I take him over to your house. Your house. Y'all be house. And he's just love. I mean, well, he loves them now. I mean, he knows when I come home and all of that. I understand that because, you know, we fed him. But listen, love has to have some roots. And Peter now, after you get saved and you're being perfected and growing, Peter says, let me love you. Let me help you understand what love is. Go to 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 22. Seeing ye have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit unto unfeigned love of the brethren, see that you love one another with a pure heart fervently. Now, he's writing to the church, right? He's writing to the persecuted church that is really standing together in persecution. But he tells them two things, and I want you to get this as we just start. You're redeemed to be holy. First of all, you're being purified. We got to be holy people, and we talked about that. But also, he says, I want you to love the brethren. The brethren. Look around. If these are Christians next to you, they're your brethren. He says in Galatians 6:10, as we therefore opportunity do good unto all men, what? Especially unto them who are the household of what? Faith. Isn't it interesting that Peter has to tell the church to love each other? Now, he's not talking about loving the world. And this is where we get a little more sideways. We need to love the people in the world. But the love for the brethren needs to be stronger. Why? Because we're birthed into the family. So our love for each other, he's saying, needs to be stronger. It needs to be more committed. Because why? Verse 23, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. Tonight, hopefully we're going to learn how to grow. The word of God is so important to grow, not just mentally, but spiritually. But you get saved. When you get saved, the word of God shows you you're a sinner, convicts you you need a savior, and that word of God is a seed. And that seed wants to grow. But there's some unnatural things or natural things that are now unnatural because you're saved in the way, called the flesh. But love, listen, if you're truly saved, you don't have to act out love. You have to let love out. Because God has put it through his seed in you. You have the love of God in you, but you are in the way. Verse 24, for all flesh is as the grass, and all the glory of man as the flowers of grass. The grass withers, the flower thereof falleth away. But the word of God endures forever, and this is the word which was by the gospel is preached unto you. Verse 1 of chapter 2, wherefore lay aside all malice, all guile, all hypocrisies, all envies, all evil speaking. As newborn babes, here's growth again, desire what? The sincere milk of the word that you may grow. So let me help you. How should our love be? This morning, if we could get a hold of this, I want you to know, we could stop saying, I know I need to love them. Well, I just know I need to love them. How many said that? I'm a Christian, so I know I should love them. You ever been irritated? You know what I'm saying? I got to love them, but I don't need to like them. You know, we just got to start splitting hairs. You know, and this is tough on me because, you know, I hope each and every person here understands that I love them. I really do. And I've been here 13 years, and I've ticked almost everybody off, just so you know. But I'm probably the only pastor with low blood pressure. Because I'm not going to talk behind your back. I mean, be honest, Mark and I things out because, but he says he doesn't tell anybody, and I'll kill him if he shares it. But anyway, in love. But you got to do that. But I want you to know, if I said something behind your back, I already. Because my love isn't me going, oh, you're just doing such a great job. And then I turn around and go, I just hate this. No, some of y'all just want me to praise, and I want to be more of that. But I'm also more wired that you need to be doing it for the Lord. And I just get weary. Well, you know, I had to, whatever. Fill in the blank. And now I'm supposed to appreciate it even greater. But it's with Jerry this morning. It's like having a bunch of kids, isn't it? I got to come in. People move stuff. So what do I got to do? Got to move it back. People leave stuff. What do I got to do? I got to move it. Got to throw it away. I got to. It's like, look, pick up after yourselves. Right? I mean, there's stuff left all over from Upwards yesterday. You lazy bums. But I'm happy that we're here for Upwards, but then now I got to do, you know what I'm saying? Nah. But I'll just tell you. But here's the thing. To me, love, you know, love is me sharing what I think. And then at the end, guess what? We're going to be on the same page. And you're going to know I like you, even though there's people here that's been in this church that's in all sorts of sins. I think they still think, no, I love them. Do they know I dislike what they're doing? I'm pretty sure. But there's people in sin, when they show up, I still hug them. But I'm not going to go, oh, no, you're. I'm not going to say, oh, it's glad you're here. I'm glad you're following the Lord. No, if you ain't following the Lord, you ain't going to hear me go as your pastor. I'm so thankful that you're following the Lord. You're living in sin. You see what I'm saying? Yup. Y'all going to have to stay through Sunday school if I don't get going. First of all, let's define it. Unfeigned love. To be unfeigned love means to be inexperienced in the art of acting. Don't fake it. Unfeigned means you're not experienced in acting. How many have been around a good salesman? They can act. They can act. I mean, it's not an act in the sense that, but when they walk in, I don't care what type of work you're in, they're going to try to connect, right? You want to make some type of personal connection. And if they're, you know, if they're selling to auto dealerships, they're going to learn something about cars, tools, and things that go on. So when they come in, what? We connect. If they see a Rams poster up, they're going to go, oh, hey, you like the Rams, right? They connect. Acting. God says, I don't want the love of the brethren to be an act. I don't want you coming on Sunday saying Christian things so we think you're in. I want you to be you. Proverbs 27:6 says, as faithful are the wounds of a friend, but the kisses of an enemy are what? Deceitful. Faithful are the wounds of a friend. And so we got to be people who go, stop back. I want to love you. I don't know anyone who'd been in this church, past, present, and that if they called at 2 o'clock in the morning, I wouldn't put my clothes on and come and find them. I mean, it wouldn't be a problem. Even though I understand that we might have had differences, or I might have spoke my mind to what is happening, but it is the way it is. Here's the other thing. Not only sanctified and cleansed with the washing of the water by the word. Now, understand this, pure heart comes through salvation. I can't love you unless I get saved. When I got saved, that's when I understood how to love someone, because God put the seed of his love in my heart. You understand that? I can fake love before I got saved, but after I'm saved, I understood love because I experienced the love of God. Now, he says it's in a pure heart. I want you to do it fervently. In other words, intensely and continually. Get this. See, when God, and I wish we could somehow destroy church and rebuild it. Because church is not made for what we do on Sunday morning. You know what I mean? Church is not made to have a service. Services are good because this is our culture. This is where we are. This is where we're at. But church is for us to be committed totally to one another. God, as a body, says, I'm placing you in here to be committed to the person over there, and I'm going to give you the love in order to connect to that person so that we become a body that is more important than anything that is in the world. But our culture has made it a service. And so you think if you endure the 40 minutes to an hour, you did church. But really, you should be committed Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. And we're committed to each other. You know what they said? What they say. I've had people, it's always funny when people say, you know, they told me this. Is it true? It's always funny to ask someone that when someone told someone and hurt someone's feelings. Is it true? Well, you don't care about me. No, is it true? You know what I mean? Right? Love is honest. It's just honest. I can't live any other way in my mind. It just doesn't work. I do try to be tactful. I'm not good at it, but I try. It just cracks me up. You know, sometimes tactfulness is finally unconditional love. This is how it works. God loves me, right? And I love you. And he's placed us in this body of Christ. Do you understand that? This is it. I didn't choose Donna. Donna didn't choose me. God said, Donna, Joe, here. Right? And he gave us roles. Not dinner roles. But roles, positions, things to do. And he says, now y'all work together. Well, how's that going to work? Well, we got to love God. And we got to let the love of God grow in us so we love one another. And we understand the body is important. But what's the problem? Well, sin moves in. Selfishness moves in. And then we start to rub out God. And we start to rub out you. And we start to rub out the body. And so it becomes about selfishness and sin. And so love then comes this happiness in things. Or this happiness in an experience. Or this happiness in something else. And love is when you tell me something I want to hear. Love is when you give me something I want to receive. Love is me, me, me. And it becomes all about me. And this love then becomes this indrawing thing where we're trying to draw love from everyone. And we just want to come to church and have someone accept me the way I am and love me for who I am and just wall over me even though I'm doing things wrong and just say, I love you, I love you, I love you, instead of saying, hey, there's a better life. You may leave Sunday from some churches feeling a whole lot more loved, but you're not better on Monday. I don't want to make people just feel good on Sunday if I don't give anything that will help them on Monday. Who cares if you came and spent 2 hours just praising the King of Kings, Lord of Lords, while you already have just ripped off your employer, you've already cheated on your wife, you've already done all these sins, and now you just want to come and praise God and say He loves me and accepts me unconditionally, and we can't get to real praise of Jesus because your heart is wrong. You understand? I'm preaching on love, and y'all are making it hard. Verse 23, being born of corruptible seed, of incorruptible by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. So what happens? Follow along. He says, because of this love that God has given you, because you're born again and being perfected, I want you to start laying aside. I want you to start putting away. I want you to start getting rid of some stuff. It's like people who've been older when they get married, right? You know, we didn't have to get rid of anything when we got married. We didn't have anything. You know what I'm saying? But if you're older and you get married, all of a sudden the wife's like, you got to get rid of that sofa. Uh-uh. That's comfy. You know what I'm saying? Or the spouse, you know, whatever. They're just, right, coming together. So God says, look, I love you and I accepted you. And I took you as who you are. But now I want you to get rid of some things. I want you to move out some items from your life. And so he says this. I want you to, first of all, to get rid of all malice. Really, if you want to do it, it's the old nature, the pre-conversion wrongdoing to others, ill will. Anything that you do wrong, he says, I want you to stop doing wrong. And he puts the word all there. So, you know, whatever. Well, I'm still working on it. No, get rid of it. Well, I'm trying to get rid of it. No, the seed of love of God needs to grow. So when you get rid of it, the love grows. So you got to get rid of it so the love to grow. Right now, the weed of malice is in the way. And it's just because known as a term for any really wicked or wrongdoing or anything that's against God. Then he says all guile. And guile is an adulterate, to adulterate or handle deceitfully, doing something behind the back. In other words, he says, I want you to get rid of any wrongdoing in your life and any wrongdoing you're doing secretly. I want you to get rid of it. I just get rid of it. Yeah, we all got secrets. No, God says don't keep any secrets. Get rid of it. Just move it out. So if the love of God, see, the reason we can't love each other the way we should love one another is because we have malice and gall in our hearts. We got wrongdoing, and we do some things that are deceitful or unknowing, and we don't want to get rid of those because no one knows about it. And so everyone thinks I'm okay. But Peter says, now look, you're being persecuted for the love of Christ, and I want you to get rid of sin. We're laying our life down for Jesus, and you told us to love each other, and the reason we can't love each other is because you still got malice and gall in your heart. I'm like, what? Shouldn't someone be going there dying for Christ? There was a great preacher one time came to Dr. Adrian Rogers' church, and I can't remember his name right now, but you would know it if I said it probably. But he said, Adrian Rogers, this guy in the face right before he went out to preach. He said, don't get on that platform with any known sin in your life. I don't want you to quench anything that God's doing. What do we do if someone shows up? Oh, praise God, this guy's just awesome. No, Peter is like, man, get rid of it. Then he does this. He says, I want you to get rid of hypocrisies, flattery, and playing a role. He goes, I don't want you to be deceitful. Just be you. Come clean before God. Stop envying other people, being jealous of what they got. Stop evil of what other people are doing. God says, look, I want love. God, right now, this morning, if you're saved, born again, has placed His love in your heart. He's given you that seed. He wants you to grow. And He says, I want this to get away, but there's some weeds there's some things producing bad fruit, and it's malice, and it's guile, and it's envy, and it's hypocrisies, and it's evil speaking. And he says, I want you to just get rid of that stuff. I want you to get rid of it so the love of God can flow. I want you to be able to be real with one another. I want you to be able to be open with one another in the love of God. I want you to be caring for one another in the love of God. I want you to be strengthening to one another in the love of God. But that only comes about when we understand we're brethren and we're committed to each other. Because it's hard for me to say what I need to say to you as a pastor if I think you're just going to leave. Because then all I got to do is pacify you. And if I got to pacify you this week, I'm going to have to pacify you again next week. Verse 2. As newborn babes, desire to sincere milk of the word that you may grow thereby. So let me just, what's Peter saying? He's saying, stop being a baby. This is what Peter is saying. Cut it out. Grow up. You ever see kids? I should have just recorded school this week. It's the most fascinating thing. These two kids will be playing. They're excited. And little Johnny, is there a Johnny? Good. Little Johnny takes the motorcycle. And all of a sudden, what's wrong? Johnny won't let me have the motorcycle. So? That's baby love, right? But then right after, Johnny gives him the motorcycle. He no longer wants it. They go play with something else. And guess what? They're friends again. That's the baby, right? That's baby. Peter is saying, grow up. Stop being baby-loving Christians. Get back into the reality of what is happening. Allow God's word to grow in you. We're going to look at that hopefully more in depth tonight because it's so important. It's not just intellectual things, but I got to remind you, you need to be in the word often, not just daily, but often, and allow the word of God to feed your soul, to feed your spirit, so you can grow. Then be committed to one another. That's really one of the biggest high points of love. It's like, I'm in with you. I'm in. You know? And you know, we live in a small town, so you got to be more in than if you were in a big town. This is the hardest thing for pastors to understand. It's harder to replace people in a town of 2,000 that are connected to everyone than it is if I was in St. Louis. When you pastor in St. Louis, you just say, look, I'm just tired of you. They just replace. You're no longer whatever. You don't do that here. Because, you know, people are committed to each other. Because that's my uncle, brother, sister, mother on my father's side. And we'd be cousins or something. But committed, man. God says, look, grow up in a way that you're committed to what God is going to do in the church. I am so blown away. If there's one thing about pastoring that just blows me away is how many people say, boy, I love you, I love you, I love you, I love you, I love you. I ain't coming back. I mean, it's just like that. I'm just like, I got people who came often and people come to me and say, where they been? They say, they ain't coming back. What happened? Why? I did this. What? Yeah, I ain't coming back. You did. Yeah, and I even go, this is all I did. Yeah, but I did all this for you. I know, I'm done, gone. I'm just like, okay. Happened a dozen times at least. It's just funny to me. I mean, people, last church, people I go to breakfast with every week and pray. Next week, we don't like you. I never did like you. Oh, sorry, flesh comes in, you know what I'm saying? Be truthful and honest. That's love. Man, I am fine with us sitting down and talking whatever through. I am. But I'm going to be honest with you. You know what I'm saying? Most people think they're just going to convince me. And some, that's not the way it happens. Sometimes I'm very convinced. And God shows me I'm wrong. But then I got to be happy for them. Man, I one thing God has really helped me. You know, when you sacrifice and you don't have, and you see people who you deemed aren't sacrificing and have, it's hard to be happy for them. But God's just given me a blessing. I honestly love seeing y'all get things. Now, some of the things y'all get, I'll never understand. But I get excited. It's, you know, it's like the day we were painting the bus. We all had to take a field trip to see Bob's new rake. They all went, oh, come see this rake. And we stood there for a few minutes. I'm like, there's a bus to paint. What in the world are we looking at? Why does anyone even want to see it? But y'all will drive a million miles to go see a bull. And I'm now happy that y'all bought someone else's bull. Opened up for a whole lot there. And I just don't understand. You know, but I'm to the place God is giving. Man, it's cool that if that's how God's blessing in your life and you're not ripping God off and he's giving you whatever, that is so awesome. I mean, I go out and I celebrate whatever that thing is out there that changes week to week. You know, some little thing. But be happy for them. We got to get to the place. Look, God doesn't bless me the way he blesses you, and he doesn't, and we need to be okay with that. Because I'm where God wants me to be, doing what God. Don't bring others down. Now, see, when you don't love properly, you start to destroy other people and bring them down. So what's love? Let me sum it. I have skipped, I know. But let me sum it up here. You'll experience love in God. You'll experience love in God. Do you understand that? This morning, if you're truly saved, the love of God is in you. You got it. You don't have to try to love someone. You have to lay aside these other things so the love of God can come out. And it doesn't mean that you accept everything the other person does. It just means you're committed with them regardless of what the other person does. Right? See, if your salvation is based in knowledge without experience, you will strive to act out love instead of let love out. This morning, Peter is talking, and this is the most fascinating thing to me, dedicated Christians who are dying for the faith, and he says, look, you got to start loving each other. I'm like, what? So if it's a problem with these dedicated Christians, then it's probably a problem at Memorial Baptist Church. And some may think they're not loved, and it's not because they're not loved. It's because they think they should be accepted the way they are instead of taken the way they are and made acceptable in the beloved. You'll live out love as you grow in God. Let me just challenge you with this and we'll close. The only way to grow in God's love is to grow in God's word. And listen, I'm more convinced we've probably done more harm saying read God's word daily. You should just take it in all the time, often. Because we've created people who will read their chapter and be done. But they're not growing, you know? I mean, we'll look at it tonight. Hopefully you come back in 6. But the Word of God not only helps us intellectually where we get verses that build upon what we should and shouldn't do, but it helps us spiritually, where the inner man is renewed and grows by taking in the Word of God as if we drank milk, or if we had steak, or if we had potatoes. It's nourishment for the spiritual growth, so that we can then have the strength to put things aside. Because one sign of maturity is being able to lay things aside and say, it's okay for Johnny to play with my motorcycle. It's maturity. But in order to get there, you got to grow, people. And so what this morning, it was a hard message to put together, because I really didn't know how I wanted to end. And I knew we had communion in the middle and all that was happening. And I appreciate it. But listen, this morning, some of y'all feel unloved because you don't understand love. Some of y'all are like, no one loves me, and everyone loves you. Do you understand? You know, some people won't try to intervene in your life. They wouldn't do it if they don't love you. But because they love you, they want to help you. That is love. And so I just pray this morning that we could get to the place that the love of God just grows in our mind. That we're able to be honest and open with each other, hopefully in loving ways. But we don't live in this hypocrisy, but we got to understand we're committed to each other. We can't storm out. We can't leave. We got to say, no, we're in. We're in. And then you know what happens? Is the world starts to see a real love in the body. And they go, what is up with that? Stand with me. Father.